Let's go back now to the question of quantum metrology. Actually, metrology in general is about parameter estimation. And parameter estimation may allow you, for instance, is involved in the following problems. For instance, you might want to estimate the underground distance of an oil deposit based on sound reflection. That's a very good way to sell quantum metrology to Petrobras, you know, the Brazilian oil company. Or you might want to estimate a weak classical force acting on a quantum system, or the time duration of a process. That's related to Seth's talk yesterday. Or you want to estimate the phase shift of an interferometer due, say, to the slight motion of the mirrors, or to an object inserted in one of the arms. Or yet, you may want to estimate the photon number dependent phase shift of an atom crossing a cavity through measurements on the atom after exiting the cavity. Okay, so these are some problems which we might be interested on. Now, parameter estimation is also interesting for some conceptual reasons. You know, you have Heisenberg uncertainty relations, and you might ask, what is the meaning of the time-energy uncertainty relation, which was in Seth Lloyd's talk yesterday? What's the meaning of the number phase uncertainty relation? As was mentioned yesterday, this time-energy uncertainty relation has been misunderstood for a long time. And also the number phase uncertainty relation has been misunderstood, I think. People have tried to understand it by defining, say, phase operators. But phase operators are tough things to define. And in fact, there is not an unambiguous definition of that. And what I'm going to show you is that quantum metrology is the proper framework to understand these relations. Now, the idea then of parameter estimation in classical and in quantum physics is the following. You have some dynamical process which is dependent on some parameter, and you want to estimate this parameter. So you first prepare the probe in some suitable initial state, then you send the probe to the process to be investigated. You choose a suitable measurement, and then you associate each experimental result, say J, with some estimation of the parameter. Now, you need a merit quantifier, and for that you can use this quantity here, which is the standard deviation between the estimated value of the parameter and the true value of the parameter. And we are going to consider in this talk unbiased estimators, which are such that their average coincides with the true value of the parameter, not only on the true value of the parameter, but also around it. So this derivative is equal to 1. Okay? So unbiased estimators. Now, this field was the fundamental stones of this field were built by Kramer, Rao, and Fisher. Kramer and Rao showed that this standard deviation for the estimation of the parameter is bounded below by this quantity that depends on the number of repetitions of the experiment, that's the nu here, and also it depends on this function, which is called Fisher information. And you see that this function here depends on the probability density of getting an experimental result, say xi, if the value of the parameter is x. Okay? So that's the expression for the Fisher information, and that limits the precision you can get by estimation of the parameter. Now, this is a classical quantity, and then we are going to see the generalization of this to quantum mechanics. And of course, you can have classically several kinds of measurements. If you're going to measure some displacement, for instance, you better measure the position. And depending on the measurement you do, you have different values of the Fisher information. Okay? Now, Fisher showed that this inequality can actually be saturated, that is, it is possible to make it an equality when the number of repetitions goes to infinity by choosing an appropriate estimator x est. Okay, so that's Fisher's theorem. Now, what about quantum parameter estimation? Now, there are now new points to consider. First, the precision in determination of the parameter depends now on the distinguishability between quantum states corresponding to nearby values of the parameter. Okay, so that's the first difference. Second, the measurement is limited, of course, by quantum mechanical restrictions. And third is a question. Okay, maybe quantum mechanics could lead us to better precision for the same amount of resources by using special quantum states. Now, and here I have to define what resources mean, and that depends on the problem you're dealing with. That might mean, for instance, the number of atoms in atomic spectroscopy, the number of photons in optical interferometry, or the average energy of a harmonic oscillator, if you want to estimate a force acting on it. Let me give an example from optical interferometry, and actually I'm going to come back to optical interferometry frequently in this talk. So again, we have here the now well-known Mach Zehnder interferometer, and there is some phase here which you would like to estimate, and the standard limit for the uncertainty estimation of the phase is given by this expression here. If you ignore repetitions of the experiment, this is the average number of photons in the field, and you can derive this expression by looking at the scalar product between a coherent state and a coherent state with the displaced phase. This is simple to calculate. You find that for small delta theta is given by this Gaussian here, and of course the width of this Gaussian is given by this expression here, which is precisely the standard limit. So you see that the standard limit is related to the distinguishability between two coherent states with different phases. Now, can we do it better? Well, we can use noon states. They were proposed for frequency measurement with ions by Bollinger and collaborators. That was in David Wineland's group in 96. Then I think starting in 2000, Jonathan Dowling started to do some papers discussing also the states. And the idea is the following. So you start with a state like that. You have n photons in one branch of the interferometer, but you have the superposition here. They may be up or down. And then the phase shift of the state would be like that. Since you have n photons, when you have n photons in the upper branch, you'll have a phase shift like this one. The average number of photons in the state is equal to n. And now if you calculate the scalar product between the original state and the displaced state as a function of this of a small theta here, delta theta, you find very simple that it's equal to this expression. And you find that when delta theta is of the order of 1 over n, this goes to 0. Actually, this must be equal to pi over 2. So from that, you get this value of delta theta. Okay, so again, uncertainty on delta theta is directly related to this distinguishability between the two quantum states. Now, this is so frequently called the Heisenberg limit for phase estimation, while this is the so-called standard limit for phase estimation. And of course, you see here that the precision is better for the same amount of resources, and the resources here are defined as the average number of photons in the state. Okay? Now, let's go to the quantum Fisher information. Again, for quantum mechanics, you define the Fisher information in the same way as before. So it depends on this probability of getting the experimental result xi if the value of the parameter is x. But now these probabilities, of course, can be expressed in terms of the density operator in a POVM, which represents the measurement you are doing on the system. Now, and therefore, this Fisher information here corresponds to a given quantum measurement expressed in terms of this POVM. Now, if you want to find the ultimate lower bound for this uncertainty, you have to optimize this Fisher information, in fact, maximize it over all possible quantum measurements. So we define the quantum Fisher information as the maximum of this expression here over all possible measurements on the system. And this has been called the quantum Fisher information. And of course, then the ultimate precision limit would be given by this expression here, where here you have the quantum Fisher information corresponding to the best possible measurement you can do on the system. Again, it's possible to show that this limit is asymptotically attainable when ni goes to infinity. And furthermore, there is a very nice relation between the Bohr's fidelity, which is the fidelity between two states represented by density matrices rho 1 and rho 2, and rho 2. Actually, for pure states, this reduces to the magnitude square of the scalar product between the two states. And if you now take the two states as the state corresponding, look, these are states of the probe, of course. That's the probe you send to estimate the value of the parameter. So if this is the state of the probe for the true value of the parameter, and this is the state of the probe for a neighbor value of the parameter, you can expand this in terms of x minus x true, and you find that the correction to the fidelity one is given by this expression here, which shows you that the quantum Fisher information is actually related to the separability between the two states. It's a measure of separability. The bigger the quantum Fisher information, since you have a minus sign here, the bigger the quantum Fisher information, the smaller will be the fidelity, and therefore the easiest will be to distinguish the state rho x from the state rho x rho. Okay, so that's the idea. So indeed, you see that the quantum Fisher information is related to the distance, say, between states. And that's the geometrical meaning of this quantum Fisher information. Now, if you have pure states, so you start with an initial pure state of the probe, you have a unitary evolution of the probe, then the quantum Fisher information can actually be precisely calculated. You know, it looks in principle to be a hopeless task. To maximize this Fisher information over all possible measurements. However, if you have unitary evolution in a pure state, Hellstrom showed in 1976 that the quantum Fisher information has a very simple expression, is 4 times the variance of an operator, which, if you want, is actually the generator of the transformation associated with the parameter you want to estimate. So if the parameter is time, that would be like a Hamiltonian. If the parameter is a displacement, that would be a momentum operator, and so forth. So, so if this evolution is something like that, with this operator here independent of x, then it's simple to show that this h here is just equal to O. So it's the generator of the transformation. Okay? So this is the expression by Hellstrom, and then of course the Kramer-Rao expression, the quantum Kramer-Rao expression, can be expressed in this way here. It is bounded, the uncertainty in the estimation of the parameter is bounded below by this quantity, which depends on the variance of this operator. And then you see that the trick to minimize the uncertainty, or the bound to the uncertainty, is to maximize the variance, so as to get a better precision. So, also, you see that this is the proper framework to discuss estimation of quantities like elapsed time or harmonic oscillator phase. These are treated here as parameters, and the uncertainty relation we had before is really a Kramer-Rao relation, which limits the error you can make in estimating the parameter. Let me give you some example, and for more details you can see this paper here. Suppose, for instance, you are interested in estimating a special displacement. So you have a transformation like this on the probe, and h, in this case, is given by the momentum operator. So using the previous formula, we find that the quantum Fisher information is just given by the variance of the momentum. So the uncertainty in the estimation of this displacement should be bounded below by this quantity. Now, this looks like the Heisenberg uncertainty relation, but of course it is not. X here is not an operator, it is a parameter. And also, if you measure this many times, you get this uncertainty going to zero. Okay? So, if you have a coherent state, then in proper units, this variance of the momentum is equal to 1. So, you find this lower bound for the estimation. And this is the so-called standard quantum limit for the estimation of displacements. On the other hand, if you maximize the variance, you could have a better precision. And maximizing the variance means using squeeze states. And of course, it's intuitive that if you use a squeeze state, you get a better precision on the estimation of the displacement. Okay? Now, so let's go back now to optical interferometry using these new concepts. So we want to estimate the uncertainty, the estimation of this phase here. Now we know that the number operator is the generator of phase displacements. So according to the previous discussion, the quantum Fisher information should be proportional to the variance of this operator. And this is the variance of the photon number in the upper arm. Now, if you pick up coherent states, then the variance of the photon number is proportional to the average photon number. So immediately you get this expression for the lower bound in the estimation of the phase. And this is the standard limit. On the other hand, if you use noon states, you see in the upper branch, that's a way to maximize the variance. You can either have zero or n photons there. So if you use those states, then you find that the variance of n in these states is equal to n squared over 4. So delta theta here is bounded below as 1 over n, which corresponds to the Heisenberg limit. So again, precision is better for the same amount of resources. But here we have made a more precise calculation of this lower bounds for the estimation. Now, what about parameter estimation with decoherence? Now, you see, decoherence is tragic for noon states. The loss of a single photon here is enough to transform this entangled state into a separable state. And if you use the separable state, either this one or this one, in fact, you have a statistical mixture of both, to measure the phase, they are useless, because the phase here will be a global phase, so no information about the phase. So the loss of a single photon destroys all information about the phase. Now, for small n, you can calculate more robust states. And in fact, this has been done in this paper, which was actually an experimental paper done in Walmsley's group. And the idea there was the following. Again, the Mach Zehnder interferometer, which I think is becoming one of the most popular devices in this workshop. So their idea was the following. They produce here 0,2 plus, actually, this system here was to produce this kind of state. I don't go into the details, but this state was numerically calculated. You see, it's not a noon state. It has this 1,1 component here. And this 1,1 component adds to the robustness of the state, because now if this state loses one photon, it remains entangled. So you can still measure the phase. And so the experiment was to prepare the state here, to send it to the interferometer. And you see now they have here a beam splitter, which acts as an artificial loss, but it's a controllable loss. They can change the transmissivity of this beam splitter, and therefore they can probe the system with different values of the losses, photon losses. Now, this is what they expected, and the experiment confirmed that. This is the uncertainty phase obtained for a coherent state corresponds to the standard quantum limit. You see that for a low at equal to 1 means complete transmittivity of this beam splitter, so no losses. At equal to 0, complete absorption of everything. So you see that the standard quantum limit, of course, the uncertainty according to the standard quantum limit becomes worse when losses increase. On the other hand, if you use a noon state, it is better than a coherent state for low losses, but then it quickly becomes worse than the coherent state for more important losses. And these are the states calculated here, which are more robust. And you see that they are better than this quantum limit, than the coherent state all over this range of values of losses, and better than the noon states as well. Okay, so in the presence of losses, the best states are not noon states anymore. You should try to see what they are. And you should try to see also what is the best bound for the evaluation of the phase. Now, they have done this calculation for 2 photons. And in fact, as we increase the number of photons, the calculation gets worse and worse. It becomes a tough problem to calculate the states and find the best bounds. So the question, our question was, what happens when n increases? Is there a simple way to figure out what would be this lower bounds in the presence of decoherence? And then our idea was the following. And as I mentioned, this was the origin of this idea was in this student here, Bruno Escher. The idea was the following. You have a system here, which is undergoing decoherence. And then you purify it with some environment. So you look at the purified evolution here. And you look at the quantum Fischer information associated to this whole thing, S plus E. Okay? So that means that you are now allowed to make measurements on the whole thing. Yeah? And of course, now we are dealing with unitary evolution, for which we have analytic expressions. And we know that the quantum fishing information for this whole thing is proportional to the variance of the generator of the corresponding to the parameter we want to estimate. So this is the quantum fishing information for measurements made on the whole thing. And we call it C of Q, while this is the quantum fishing information corresponding to measurements on the system alone. You see, the measurements are specified here, identity over E, and a POVM over the system. Of course, this should be bounded above by this, because the set of measurements is larger than the set of measurements here. Okay? So we have this inequality. The quantum fishing information for the whole thing is an upper bound for the quantum fishing information of the system alone. And the physical meaning of this bound is that information obtained about the parameter when S plus E is monitored, and you get more information in general than if you monitor S alone. Now, of course, we are interested in calculating the least upper bound, because that's when we are going to get closer to the quantum information of the system that we are interested in. We don't want the quantum fishing information for the whole thing. Okay? So, in order to do that, we would have to minimize this over all possible unitary evolutions in S plus E. And that's a difficult problem. Now, we showed in this paper here that this bound is actually attainable. In other words, that's an existent theorem. We showed that there is always a purification such that C of Q coincides with F of Q. And the physical interpretation, the physical meaning for that is the following, that for this special purification, monitoring S plus E yields the same information as monitoring S alone. So you get redundant information, if you want, on these correlations, on this total measurement of S plus E. Now, again, this is an existence theorem, and then you might ask, but come on, I mean, why did you work on that? Because after all, you know, finding the nice environment looks like a Superman activity, right? In fact, we would need some kind of a demon for that. But you know, this is not a malicious demon. Huh? He actually tries to find the best environment, the best measurement, so as to give us the correct quantum fishing information for S alone. Now, what I'm going to show you is that for some cases, we can find actually the best purification based on physical arguments. And in other cases, we cannot find the best purification, but we can find some very good purifications that gives us some very good lower bounds for the uncertainty. And we know they are good because we compare them with some numerical calculations. And they are analytical lower bounds, which allows us to look in an analytic way on this classical limit behavior of the system. Now, this minimization procedure can actually be simplified because one knows that if you have two different purifications of a system, there is always a unitary operator acting only on the environment that connects these two different purifications. So actually, if we have a purification here, then any other purification can be written like that, where this evolution operator acts on the environment alone. And that simplifies our life. We define this small he as the, say, generator corresponding to this transformation here. And now you want to minimize C of Q over all Hermitian operators that act on E alone. And in fact, in this paper here, we show that this h of E satisfies an equation which is called as Sylvester equation, which can be, in principle, solved by numerical methods. Furthermore, it's a good starting point for an iteration procedure, so that if you have an approximate solution, you can use it to find the next approximation. Okay, it's a variation approach, and we have applied it to at least one problem to calculate the effects of diffusion on an optical interferometer. Now, let's go back to the optical interferometer, and now we have a lossy interferometer, and in order to build this artificial environment, you see, that's not a real environment. That's a mathematical environment that allows us to find this lower bound for the uncertainty. It can, you know, in general, it will not be a natural environment or even a physical environment. Okay, it's some environment such that the information obtained on measuring S plus E is the same as the information obtained by measuring S. So here we construct this environment in the following way, you know, inspired by Walmsley's experiment. We put a beam splitter here. And this is our environment. Okay? It's you know, these are the photons that escape from the system due to reflection on this beam splitter. So now we want to estimate this phase shift in the presence of losses. And the idea is the following. So you want to eliminate the redundant information on theta when you measure on S plus E. So we introduce here in the environment some dispersive element which produces a phase shift equal to theta prime. And theta prime is our variational parameter. Okay? So you calculate this quantum Fisher information for the whole thing, corresponding to theta prime here and theta here. And then we minimize C of Q with respect to theta prime. So, you know, that's always a trick. You should put some additional parameter. And the aim is to sort of reduce the information the environment has on theta. Actually, the correlations between the environment and the system have on theta. And eventually to eliminate this extra information. So let me show you the results we get for states with well-defined total photon number. That means there are states like that. So the total number in both arms is equal to capital N. And these states look like that. So we find, by applying this method, that the uncertainty in the estimation of the force is bounded below by this quantity here. Now, it's a simple quantity, which has two interesting limits. First, consider that the number of photons, the total number of photons, is much smaller than this expression here that depends on the losses. Okay? Remember, at equal to 1 means no losses, at equal to 0, complete absorption. So if n is much smaller than that, you see that this term here will be much smaller than 1. So this whole thing will be proportional to 1 over n, which is the Heisenberg limit. Okay? Now, go to the other limit. Suppose n is large enough, n is much larger than this quantity here. So now this term will dominate. You have square root of n in the numerator. So the total expression will be proportional to the inversely proportional to the square root of n, which corresponds to the standard limit scaling. Okay? So you see here how you have, so you see here that this expression actually interpolates between the Heisenberg limit corresponding to a small number of photons and the standard limit corresponding to a large number of photons. And it also shows that for n sufficiently large, 1 over square root of n behavior is always reached. So it's like the classical world telling us, well, you know, if your photon number is large enough, you know, welcome to the classical world. Huh? Now, how good is this bound? We have compared this analytic expression with numerical calculations, actually up to n equal to 100. And this is the square root of the ratio between the real quantum Fisher information of the system and our bound. You see, C of Q is always larger or equal than the quantum Fisher information of the system. So this number here should be smaller than 1. And the reason why I plot the square root of the ratio between these two quantities is that this is inversely proportional to the ratio between the uncertainties calculated, the real uncertainty and the uncertainty calculated with our bound. So you see that these are calculations made for different photon numbers and for different losses. And you see that this ratio becomes is always larger than 0.8. Okay? So we don't have a tight bound, but we are very close to the true bound. So just this physical reasoning that somehow we should do this trick with the environment and put some phase there that eliminates this extra information is sufficient to get some bound, which is actually quite nice. Okay? But it's not the true bound. Don't ask me why this is going to 0.8. In fact, if you calculate this with larger and larger, you see that this really the minimum ratio really tends to 0.8. And that's a mystery for me. Okay? I don't know why. That means that we are missing something. We should do something else to the environment. And I don't know what we should do. Okay? We have been thinking about that. Don't know. So This is an application for, this is just for optical interferometry. Now, another problem which we have dealt with this kind of techniques is the quantum speed limit. So it's this has a long story. There is this famous paper by Mandelstam and Tam in 1945, where they derived this relation by using a clock operator. So they look at the average of some operator, how that evolves with time, and they say a characteristic evolution time is given by the time it takes for this average to go a distance equal to the variance of this operator. So they got an expression like this. And then in 1990, Anandam and Aharonov made a geometric derivation of this relation, which coincides with Mandelstam and Tam, except for some constants. And the idea is to calculate the time it takes for two states to become orthogonal to each other. They did that with pure states. Okay? So we wondered if we could generalize these expressions for systems with losses, with decoherence. And then there are two problems there. First, you know, we should not have the Hamiltonian showing up if you have a lossy process or a decoherence process. So something should replace that Hamiltonian there. Second, if you have a non-unitary process, the evolved state may not become orthogonal to the initial one. Okay? So two problems. And let me show you how we can handle these problems. In fact, what you see here is a generalization of the Mandelstam-Tam relation, which we derive actually in this paper. We derive it by geometrical means, just by calculating the path followed by the system in the space of states. And tau here is the minimum time for attaining some fidelity given by this expression between initial and final states. Now, the left-hand side is the Bohr's length of the geodesic connecting the two states. And in fact, if you have pure states, that reduces to the your distance, Bill, right? And which was calculated geometrically there, and you precisely have the arc cosine of the magnitude of squared of this. Of the scalar product, actually of the magnitude of the scalar product, because you have the square root here. Okay? So this goes into Bill's expression for pure states. So this is the left-hand side. Now the right-hand side, remember that I showed you this expansion of the Bohr's fidelity, and I told you that the quantum Fisher information was related to the distance between the states. Remember also that it was multiplying some delta x square, the variation in the parameter. So if the parameter is time, delta x square will be delta t square. Yeah? And f is multiplying delta t square, so square root of f is a speed, right? It's the speed of variation of the state. And if you look at this expression here, this is actually the Bohr's length of the actual path followed by the state of the system. Yeah? And the Bohr's length is a generalization for mixed states of the study, you know, what's the name of the metric? I just forgot.
The study metric.
Huh? Study metric, yeah. But if, there is another name. Study Fubini. So it's the generalization of the study Fubini metric for mixed states. Okay? So if you consider that, then, you know, this expression is actually very simple. It just tells us that the actual path, that the actual length of the path followed by the system, or let's say the length of the actual path followed by the system, should be larger or equal than the length of the geodesic connecting the two states. That's it. Huh? And of course, this is a time, this gives me the minimal time for attaining this fidelity. And the question is, you know, what's the relation of this with Mandelstam-Tam relation? Now, first, you know, it's clearly that this bound can be attained because you only have to look for some dynamics that moves the system along a geodesic in the space of states, okay? So, and then the equal sign will work here. Now, so let's look at a special case of this expression for a unitary evolution a time-independent Hamiltonian, and orthogonal states. So we should go back to the undone Aharonov expression. So if we do that, then you see the states are orthogonal, therefore the fidelity is equal to zero. Arc cosine zero is pi over two, right? And also the quantum Fisher information in this case is four times the variance of the Hamiltonian. We assume the Hamiltonian is time independent, so this integration is just the product of square root of f over four times tau. And immediately from this expression then we get this expression here, which corresponds precisely to the Anandam Aharonov expression. Furthermore, if the Hamiltonian depends on time, we also get expressions which have been proposed in the literature for unitary evolutions and time-dependent Hamiltonians. Okay? But we can now look at more general processes. Now, you should also take a look at these two papers. This paper was published in PRL, back-to-back with ours, and it's by Afonso del Campo. And it's a different way of considering the problem. And then in the archives, there is also this paper by Defner and Eric Lutz, also with a different way and also of getting the Margulis-Levitin bounds. And there is another bound also. Anyway, Eric is here, so he should tell you about it and not me. But anyway, so now we do have a problem with our approach. Again, it's similar to the problem we had before. Okay, so that's a generalized expression, but in order to apply it, we have to calculate the quantum Fisher information for this evolving system. And that's not an easy matter, right? You have to maximize the Fisher information over all possible measurements and so forth. So in order to do that, we apply the same approach. So we purify the system. We find a quantum Fisher information for the purified system. This should be larger or equal than the quantum Fisher information of the system alone. So this means that this quantity here will be larger than the one I had before, which means that the time I get will be smaller than the one I had before. So it's not necessarily a tight bound for the minimum time, but it's a way to calculate it. And then now I have a unitary evolution of the purified state that corresponds to the to this density matrix here, and I can use the known results for unitary evolutions in order to calculate this integral here. Let me show you some applications of this idea. First, we consider the phasing channel. So this describes the evolution of a qubit in the presence of some environment. And this just tells me that, you know, if you start with the states 0 and 1, they remain so because, you know, they are multiplying the whole thing. So they are pointer states in this case. On the other hand, if you start with a superposition of 0 plus 1, they get maximally maximally entangled with the environment. So at the end of the evolution, you lose complete phase information. And this P of t here is chosen in this way, so that when t goes to infinity, p goes to 1/2. So equal weights for this term and this term, and this gives you maximal entanglement. Okay, so you lose completely phase information. And gamma here is the phasing rate. So here we have the map. Of course, we can also write down a master equation that describes the phasing. But you see, I'm really focusing on purified approaches, so I go straight to this map. And there is a unitary evolution that corresponds to the map. And you can easily verify that you can write it like that. Z is the sigma z Pauli operator. Same thing for y is the sigma y Pauli operator. You see y is an operator for the environment. Z is an operator for the system. And you can show that this unitary evolution yields precisely these equations here if you choose this angle theta to be equal to the r cosine square root of p of t. Okay? Now, so this evolution gives me this phasing channel, but again, I could choose a more general unitary evolution by applying the unitary evolution on the environment alone. And I know that any two purifications are related by a unitary evolution like that. Okay? Now, in this case, I can do it exactly. You see, the problem is to minimize C of Q over all possible evolutions of the environment. And I know that C of Q only depends on this generator of this transformation here. Now, the environment, if you look at the environment here, you see that it's really a qubit. It's a two-state system. You only have the state 0 and 1 of the environment. So the most general transformation of the environment should involve some Hamiltonian here, which is a combination of the three Pauli operators for the environment. And for us, alpha, beta, and gamma are variational parameters that I want to determine so as to minimize this quantum Fisher information for the whole thing, for system plus environment. Okay, so that's the idea. So this can be exactly done. And I'm going to show you some results, some special results. We have the general result as well. For a special case, here we have the phasing for two degenerate states, okay? Omega 0 is equal to 0. So the evolution is really due only to the phasing. And we can find that this distance here, which is the geodesic, is more or equal than this expression here. So from here you find this is the variance of the Pauli operator in the initial state of the system. You see that if the variance is equal to zero, you have an eigenstate of sigma z, so there is no evolution of the system, and then d must be equal to zero, so the state just doesn't move. So with delta z square average equal to zero, you saturate this expression. You can also saturate it when you choose the variance of z equal to 1. It's easy to show that this bound holds with a zero signal, and that's very simple to understand geometrically. If delta z square is equal to 1, that means that your state is on the equatorial plane. Okay? So it's a superposition of spin up with spin down with equal weight. So you have your state here somewhere. And since the evolution is a purely the phasing evolution, this state here will evolve along this radius of the Bohr sphere towards the center. And this is a geodesic in the space of mixed states, okay? Defined in the Bloch sphere. In other words, the superposition under the phasing becomes just the identity over 2, which is the center of the sphere. This is a geodesic, so now this evolution here with omega 0 equal to 0 and this initial state is along a geodesic, so the bound should be saturated. Okay, so that's an example for which the bound is saturated. Now, we have also applied this to more complicated systems. This, for instance, you take an n-qubit system, each qubit interacting with its own dephasing reservoir. Now, if you want really to treat this completely, it's a mess, okay? Because now we have n spins, you'll have many, oops. Let's see. Okay, so you have many parameters to determine. Instead of doing that, we chose a symmetric combination of the three, of the Pauli operators, which are collective Pauli operators. And we tried a Hamiltonian like that. And then we showed that we get a lower bound that scales as tau equal to 1 over n. That's for the minimum separation time. And we also show that this bound is attained for GHZ states of this sort, okay? Which is predictable since we have here a symmetric gas. And indeed, it works because symmetric states are indeed the best states that saturate the bound. We have shown also that any other state gives me a minimal time, which is above the bound we get. So they saturate the bound, and we do get a bound which is valid for n. In qubit state for the phasing process. Now, summary, I have shown you here a general framework for estimation of parameters in noisy systems, and they are based, this scheme is based on an expression of the quantum Fisher information for the purified evolution. And this allows analytical calculation of some very good bounds on the limits of estimation. And we have obtained bounds for optical interferometry, not only for photon losses, but also for diffusion noise. Atomic spectroscopy, minimum evolution time of open systems, and also we're just finishing some work on force estimation, okay, where you can apply the same ideas. And I'd like to finish just showing you some picture of the group. It's not a very recent picture, so some people have left, others have come, but the color code is the following. Green for students, it's natural, right, the color of hope. Blue for postdocs, I don't want to comment on that. And red for professors, and please do not take any political implication for that. So congratulations, Wojciech, for birthday and your brilliant career. Actually, it does hold true. There is a recent paper by Makay Tsung from Singapore, where he actually applies our method to a multimode situation, okay, for the optical interferometer, and he finds the result, which I have not looked at that in detail, but his result looks very much like ours, except that he has the power spectrum of the system, which is very nice. So since our result is not a tight bound, you see it's a 0.8, I imagine that his result is not a tight bound either, but I have not verified that. But so it can be generalized actually to a multimode system.
Absolutely beautiful work, and I love it. And my question is this, you gave a couple of examples. I know also back at MIT, our colleagues on LIGO, the laser interferometer for derivation waves,
yes,
but using squeeze states to get more accurate position measurements, which you measured follows nicely as next derived from Jordan. Could you just give a handful of other examples you think are very cool about how this has already been applied? Just squeeze states, awesome for position, these other states, awesome for phase. What other things would you list?
Okay, cool. You see, we have a paper in the archives, but it's just the first version of a paper we should submit probably next week. Okay, it's almost ready. And the paper is on the estimation of forces acting on damped harmonic oscillators. Okay, and it's we're very happy with this result because for several reasons. It was really like that. I will show you, I'll just tell you a curious story. I had the student working on that, Camille, we had an idea about how to calculate the quantum information for the whole system. And the chairman is looking at me, but maybe I can have some time because I think it's interesting. Anyway, so you have a damped harmonic oscillator, and then my background is quantum optics, right? So I think about a mode of the field in a beam splitter. And that's the environment like we did before. And then we have this mode going through the beam splitter. So the beam splitter produces some losses. That's the damping of the harmonic oscillator. And you have access to the environment principle, theoretically. And then we inject a coherent state here with a partially transmission beam splitter. So this coherent state represents the force acting on the oscillator. It displaces the state in phase space. Okay, so that's the force, and it satisfies the same equation as the damped forced harmonic oscillator. But now we have this environment here, right? So we can put another beam splitter here and inject another coherent state with amplitude and phase to be determined, which sort of cancels the information on the force in the environment or in the correlations. And we can calculate the quantum information for the whole quantum Fisher information for the whole thing, okay? By measuring momentum, actually, in this case. But anyway, so by measuring the proper quadrature, okay? Now, my student, so first he had calculated the Fisher information, or the quantum Fisher information, for the dissipative harmonic oscillator, doing momentum measurements to evaluate the forces, natural. And then he did this calculation. And he came with his result saying, oh, come on, you know, I did this calculation and I got the same result as before. So, you know, that means that this environment was actually the best environment. So the quantum Fisher information for the whole thing coincided with the Fisher information he had calculated for this kind of momentum measurement. So in this case, we have the exact bound, okay, for the estimation of the amplitude of the force, okay, exact bound. And furthermore, we can also discuss something which I think is very much related to what experimentalists do, because, you know, you measure during some time, but there is an optimal time for measurement, because if you measure for too short a time, you don't get information on the force. If you wait for too long a time, then there is damping, and you lose memory of the initial state, so, you know, it's not worth it. So you calculate the optimal time, and you do successive measurements. And if you do that, again, you find an exact bound, which is very close to the bounds calculated, and I really invite them, you know, by experimentalists like in Dave Wineland group and also by Braginski, doing heuristic arguments, you know, compared with the thermal noise, and which are very good arguments. So they have that bound, we get that bound with all the correct parameters in front, because this is a precise bound, okay? So we get a lower bound also by successive measurements. So that's an example, which I think may be relevant for this LIGO, but of course we have to work more in order to approach it to this experiments, you know, it's because you have radiation reaction and so forth, and we have to work on that. But anyway, so it's just a first approximation to this kind of problem.
One more question. Can I actually ask you to comment on that little focus? So,
yes.
So it's a very nice, obviously, this is very good. But I mean, as you say, for practical situations, there's always a trade off between using, say, funky entangled three states that have better temporal resolution, but the rate of interaction with the environment and the amount of time you want to wait before you're measure. Do you have, you just said that this is an open question, do you know some more quantitative trade-offs between those
yeah. Three? Well, you know, I'm not sure I can answer it fully, but what I can tell you is the following. Within this, I would say simple model, that simple model that we have considered, this, you know, dumped harmonic oscillator, interact with some force, and we are humble in that with modest, so you don't want to know the waveform, like, you know, Caves has done with McKay again in some recent paper. We assume that the waveform is normalized to one, and we want to know the amplitude, just a single parameter. So within that model, we can calculate everything exactly, and we find that the best state is a squeezed state. The resource we consider is the average energy of the harmonic oscillator, so you fix that, and then you find that the best state is a squeezed state. Okay, it's not, it's entangled in the modes, if you want, but yeah, sure. That's it. And we can also find the best time. Now, of course, this precise trade-off, we are discussing it, because when we find the best time, we're still using the squeezed states we calculated before, you see. And maybe the states should change as well. And,
sure.
And this we don't know, how it goes. Yeah, but you know.
Let's thank Luiz again.